Welcome, I'm Prudence Robertson, and this is EWTN Pro-Life Weekly.
Defying the law, a woman is facing felony charges after assisting her daughter with an illegal, dangerous chemical abortion and planning to burn the evidence, that is, the unborn baby. Chelsea Youman, National Legislative Advisor at Human Coalition Action, joins us to share more details in the case. Pro-abortion pop stars. Grammy-winning artist Lady Gaga is the latest superstar to join in the pro-abortion cheerleading of many in her industry, stopping her concert here in Washington, D.C. to proclaim her pro-abortion beliefs. I speak out and share a message of hope and reality for these, quote, pro-woman artists. Tearing us apart. Pro-life scholar Ryan Anderson and pro-life journalist Alexandra DeSanctis join forces to release an important guide in navigating public opinion on abortion and pro-life policy. Their captivating book, Tearing Us Apart, How Abortion Harms Everything and Solves Nothing, reframes the ongoing abortion debate with the truth. Both pro-life advocates joined me in studio to talk about our post-Roe era.
This week, on the Feast of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary, EWTN celebrated the 41st anniversary of its on-air launch. As we commemorated this special day, others did too. The Republican National Committee released a statement saying, quote, "The Republican Party joins Catholics across America in celebrating the Feast of the Assumption. On this solemnity, Catholics can know that Republicans will always stand for the sanctity of life and to preserve our nation's long tradition of religious liberty and an American's right to live out his or her faith." And shifting gears to some state news, a woman in Nebraska is being charged with aiding and abetting an abortion, violating the state's 20-week ban on abortion. The 41-year-old gave dangerous chemical abortion pills to her teenage daughter, who was about 24 weeks along. After the baby was killed, it's been reported that she went as far as burning and then burying the baby's body. Nebraska authorities were able to obtain information about the case via Facebook messages between the mother and daughter. Joining me now for insight is Chelsea Youman, National Legislative Advisor at Human Coalition Action. Chelsea, thanks for joining me. Could you explain what you know about this case out of Nebraska?
Yes, well, thank you for having me. It's really a sober and frankly a horrific situation that did happen out of Nebraska. A 17-year-old girl, so a minor girl, and allegedly a 22-year-old man who impregnated her, ended up having an abortion through the chemical abortion pill at 28 weeks of pregnancy. If you do not know, that is the third trimester. Her mother allegedly obtained the pills. We're not sure how, but definitely illegally. This was all before Roe was overturned. So last year, she's now 18 years old. And then she went through the process, probably a very traumatic process of full labor because of the chemical abortion pills and delivering a dead child in her bathroom. And at that point, you know, the police reports indicate that they put the child in a bag, burned the remains of the human child, and then he helped assist burying in that child, allegedly. So we have what is frankly, I think, one of the most difficult and sad really a terrible situation all the way around, both for this minor girl who was put in this position, and of course for her dead unborn child. It's really a difficult and sad situation.
Right. I'm getting chills just hearing you explain it. And pro-abortion extremists, on the other hand, are calling this an invasion of privacy because this woman is facing charges after authorities obtained her Facebook messages. What's your response to that?
Yeah, so I think it's really important to know the facts and to clarify that actually all 50 states, no matter what state she would have resided in, would protect her from being charged for this abortion, even in the third trimester. So she's actually being protected from being charged for an abortion. However, one of the many laws in our society protecting victims of homicide, you, me, our neighbors, our friends, are from allowing human remains to be disposed of or burned or buried in someone's backyard. There are all laws preventing that. How we treat human bodies matters in our society. And one of the big reasons is it helped, you know, this man who was 22 years old cover up his crimes, cover up his statutory rape crimes against her by burying this child. And so we have laws in society meant to protect people and victims from scenarios like this. And it's really horrific that this happened, but we do live in a civilized society and one that really should do better by women and unborn children than this.
Yeah, thanks for your insight on that. We'll continue to track that case. In other news, Chelsea, pro-life advocates in Kansas have somewhat surprisingly called for a recount of the Value Them Both amendment votes, a measure that failed by significant margins. Right now, the state is expected to hold a partial vote recount. In a statement after the vote, you said the amendment was not, quote, crystal clear or easily explainable. Do you think that's why the amendment failed?
I think there are a few reasons that it failed. We know that exorbitant amounts of money on both sides of the aisle were poured into this. There was a high turnout in Kansas. And I think that the other side did a really good job maybe ostracizing pro-lifers or making, you know, our views seem extreme when we know that their side is advocating for what we just talked about, third trimester, late term abortions up until birth, and really in several states now, even infanticide after birth. And so our side has work to do. We need to continue to just show their hand at how extreme they are, how pro-death they are. But also, I think we could refocus here in Kansas. I love the passion in that state for life. The fact that they're calling for a recall shows that passion and dedication. But I think that we could channel that passion and dedication towards eliminating the distribution of the abortion pill, doing things like holding those who aid and abet abortions illegally accountable, the physicians and the pharmacies, holding them accountable for wrongful death. There's lots of legislative measures that at Human Coalition Action we've been working on. We have them drafted. Many of them are on our website at hucoaction.org. And we have a lot of work to do as a movement, including work to serve mothers in need and their unborn children through tangible help and resources.
Well, we encourage all of our viewers to check out your website. Chelsea Youman, thanks for joining us from Human Coalition. God bless you.
Thanks for having me. We'll talk to you later.
Yeah, thanks. To continue this discussion, we're joined now by Elizabeth Kirk, Associate Scholar at the Charlotte Lozier Institute and the Director of Center for Law and the Human Person at Catholic University of America. Elizabeth, thanks for joining me. You recently wrote an article at Public Discourse where you explained that the Value Them Both Amendment failed because it's difficult to communicate complex legal and political principles. Could you explain that a little bit more?
Sure. Many people don't realize that the Kansas constitutional amendment effort was not an affirmative pro-life effort. Rather, it was a reaction to a very extreme decision by the Kansas Supreme Court. Back in 2019, the court held that there was a state constitutional right to abortion, and they adopted this very strict test under which nearly all existing and future abortion legislation will likely be struck down. And there are only two ways to correct a bad Supreme Court decision. Either a future Supreme Court has to overrule it, or the people have to pass a constitutional amendment. And so that's all that the Value Them Both Amendment was about, was removing this judicially invented right to abortion and restoring to the people the right to legislate in this area. But because so few abortion laws had actually been struck down so far, pro-choice advocates were able to kind of step in and create a lot of confusion, and pro-life advocates were on their heels trying to explain this complicated Supreme Court decision, strict test they adopted, the way that it would apply, and abortion advocates were able to take advantage of that confusion and scare voters that it would lead to a total ban on abortion. Mm. Stop ban was a ubiquitous sign seen throughout Kansas in the weeks leading up to the election. So people were very confused about what gave rise to the need for it and what the amendment itself would do.
Right. And so how can we avoid that confusion in the future? You know, there are a couple of other states with upcoming ballot initiatives on pro-life measures this year, such as Michigan and California. Mm-hmm. What should our strategy be moving forward?
Well, I think it's first important to clarify that the amendment in Kansas was neutral on abortion. So again, all it would have done was restore to the people the ability to fashion abortion policy. The measures you mentioned, Michigan and California, they are full-throated efforts to constitutionalize unlimited access to abortion at any time for any reason at taxpayer expense. So that's one important thing to understand. I think the lessons we learn in Kansas is that we have to harness the emotional power of truthful stories and to expose the radical pro-abortion agenda. We can't be defensively reassuring voters that we're not going to throw women in jail for having a miscarriage, right? Instead, we need to make proponents of these initiatives own what it is that they're supporting, which again is unlimited access to abortion throughout pregnancy for any reason. And pro-life advocates, I think, can prepare themselves for this by educating themselves on the law, the science, the medicine, and share those stories in a compelling way that captures the imagination and the hearts of people. Mm.
And a spokesperson from Value Them Both, which is the predominant pro-life group that favored the Kansas amendment that failed, told Fox 4 News in Kansas City that their, quote, focus now is moving the cause of life forward in Kansas, not looking back to August 2nd. Do you think that's wise advice for the movement right now?
In Kansas, absolutely. I mean, I think they need to advance the cause of life in two ways in Kansas. One, of course, is to, within the constraints of this terrible Supreme Court decision, try to advance pro-life policy in law. But second of all, they need to recognize that abortion, Kansas is going to become an abortion destination state. Abortions are already up in the state 13% since that bad Supreme Court decision. And so they're going to need to do more in terms of, compassionate resources available to women, alternatives to abortion to care for women who are coming into the state. Mm.
Elizabeth Kirk from Charlotte Lozier Institute and the Catholic University of America, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
We have a new reporter at our sister publication, Catholic News Agency. Edie Heipel is CNA's new political correspondent. She previously worked in communications for Center for Renewing America and served in the Trump administration's Office of Management and Budget. In her first few weeks at CNA, she's been reporting on abortion, transgender issues, inflation, and other matters of importance to American Catholics. And Edie Heipel joins me now in studio. Edie, thanks so much for being here today.
Thanks for having me on, Prudence.
Yeah, and welcome to Catholic News Agency and the EWTN team. You recently reported about a new rule issued by the Biden administration that would force doctors to perform abortions and be involved in very dangerous, invasive transgender surgeries. Can you explain how Catholics can fight back against this?
Right. Well, as you mentioned, this new rule by the Biden administration really is harmful, and if finalized, will really cause problems for Catholics who oppose these procedures because of their religious beliefs. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think a lot of Catholics, myself included, really feel powerless in these recent attacks against our faith. So I wrote a primer explaining how people can speak out against this and how their comments can be taken seriously, which will go on to affect the rulemaking. As I outline in my primer, people can go to the Federal Register and issue public comments that, if they're tailored to be meaningful and substantial, will go into the final rulemaking process. Mm. This is just one way that people can make their voices feel heard and do something to change the impact of this rule.
That's good to know. And speaking of holding our federal authorities accountable, do you know of any updates on the DC 5? As a reminder for our viewers, these are the five babies who were found in a medical waste bin. We believe that they were aborted late term, possibly illegally.
Right. There's no update. As you know, the last time this issue was addressed, Congress had called on the DOJ and FBI to investigate the deaths of these preterm, almost full-term babies found in D.C. Mm-hmm. Instead, these same agencies have been focused on investigating Lauren Handy, who found the babies in D.C., mm-hmm. and raiding the house of the most pro-life president in history, instead of investigating why there are five nearly full-term children left to die alone in our nation's capital.
Very unfortunate, and that's a really good point. Edie, you come to EWTN with experience working in President Trump's administration and for the Center for Renewing America. Can you talk to me about how your experiences there are going to shape your reporting here at EWTN?
Right. Well, I was fortunate to be a part of a team both in the administration as well as at the Center for Renewing America, where we relentlessly pursued how the executive branch has been used to weaponize, our Catholic values, our faith, policies against families and children, and pro-abortion policies, frankly. And that's something I really want to take into my coverage at EWTN, investigating and revealing to Catholics how these agencies have been used against our faith and what we can do to stand against that.
Right, really important. And in one of your last big projects at Center for Renewing America, you really gave a great outline of what we're looking at in this post-Roe America. You know, what are some of the challenges challenges that we're going to face as pro-lifers and as Catholics?
Right. Well, first, I want to reemphasize, you know, the overturning of Roe v. Wade was huge. It was a cause for celebration, and there's been a lot of rejoicing after that, which has been great.
Yeah.
And, you know, the pro-life movement has never fooled itself into thinking that problems wouldn't present itself after this. And some of those include, for example, medication abortion, which is really ramping up, especially on the part of the FDA, but also challenges within the movement itself as it deals with big questions, such as, for example, pro-life policies that still have existing loopholes to allow for abortion funding. Those and many other issues are what I addressed in the primer.
Very interesting. I encourage everyone to read it. And I know you're a recent convert to Catholicism, Edie. So talk to me about how, as Catholics in the media today, we have such an important role. What do you see that role being when so many people in the media aren't speaking the truth?
Sure. Well, obviously, a huge part of why I joined the Catholic Church, why I'm a convert, is because of our Catholic faith represents the fullness of truth. And that's something I believe that Catholics in the media have an obligation, a responsibility to pursuing the truth, spreading the truth, and sharing that through our writing and reporting. So that's something I want to take into this career, which is also unfolding into a broader vocation and how I came to the faith, too.
Yes. Well, we're so excited to have you in the church and here at EWTN. Edie Heipel, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Prudence.
Coming up, a well-known Grammy Award-winning artist stopped her concert in D.C. to proclaim her pro-abortion beliefs. I speak out. Plus, we speak to two authors who share facts and compelling arguments that advance the cause of life. Welcome back to EWTN Pro-Life Weekly. I'm Prudence Robertson. Lady Gaga and many other pop stars have posted to social media and gone so far as to stop their concerts to laud abortion. That is this week's Speak Out segment. National Public Radio has reported that over 60 pop stars have vocally come out in support of abortion in recent weeks. On stage, 19-year-old Olivia Rodrigo named the five justices who overturned Roe, shouting obscenities directed at the justices and making indecent gestures. Lizzo donated $1 million to Planned Parenthood. Pink took to Twitter and told her fans that if they are pro-life, they should stop listening to her music. Most recently, here in D.C., Lady Gaga stopped her concert to dedicate a song to women because, quote, every woman now has to worry about her body if she gets pregnant. So for this Speak Out, I have a message for these supposed pro-woman pop stars. Stop making this about you. Stop pitting men against women. Stop pitting women against their babies. Stop parading as free mouthpieces for Planned Parenthood, one of the most lucrative businesses that literally makes its money by killing innocent babies. These pop stars are degrading our culture more and more every day. They're beginning to look and act like robots, and it's shameful and dangerous that these people are influencing the conversation on abortion. We must pray and work for change in our society. Pro-life scholar Ryan Anderson and pro-life journalist Alexandra DeSanctis released a guide to understanding pro-life arguments in their joint venture, Tearing Us Apart: How Abortion Harms Everything and Solves Nothing. The authors use facts and logic to reveal the brutality of abortion and how it has wounded our society at its core. The book comes as Americans are getting used to what it feels like to live in a post-Roe America. Both Anderson and DeSanctis say it is important for readers to have the right tools to stand up for life. We spoke to them soon after their book release. This is what they shared with us. Joining me now are Ryan Anderson and Alexandra DeSanctis Marr. They are the authors of the new book, Tearing Us Apart: How Abortion Harms Everything and Solves Nothing. Thank you both for being here with me today. I would love to just hear from both of you to start about how you kind of came up with the idea for this book, why you wrote it now, and why you decided to collaborate on it together. I'll start with you, Alexandra.
Sure. So when we first started thinking about writing the book, it was clear to us there was a very good chance that Roe v. Wade might be overturned within the year. And so our thought was, let's provide a pro-life roadmap to the future of the pro-life movement, right? Because the overturning of Roe is not the end of the fight over abortion. It's the beginning of a new and important phase. And so we wrote a book hoping that it would be accessible, useful, even to people who don't agree with us. But first and foremost, for pro-lifers. And from my perspective, we wanted to make the case, of course, first of all, that the unborn child is harmed by abortion, is killed by abortion. But to kind of show pro-lifers a broader case, you know, that abortion has actually harmed everything it's touched. And here are all the reasons to kind of help you make that case.
Yeah, and Ryan, how did you decide to collaborate on this together, the two of you?
Sure, so this is my fifth book, and this is Alexandra's first. And so the idea was that we could collaborate because she's been covering the pro-life beat at National Review for the past 6 years. Like, this is her single-minded focus.
Right.
You know, my other books have been on marriage, they've been on religious liberty. I'm now the president of a think tank. I didn't know all the areas of this as well. I didn't have as much time. And so the collaboration, two people getting the book done, we got it done very quickly. Because, yeah, you know, we started writing the book right when oral arguments was happening in Dobbs, because we were like, we can count to five. But that meant to get it done in time to then be published to coincide with the release of Dobbs, we had to write it pretty quickly.
Right. And you guys talk about how abortion, you know, impacts other aspects of society. You know, not only is it obviously killing an unborn child, but it affects our culture in a very grave way. And we've talked on this show about how abortion is a root problem. How do you guys address that in your book?
Sure. So, I mean, we go chapter by chapter looking at first how it kills the unborn child, then how it harms women, both the physical health, the psychological health, but then also the way that it takes the male way of being incarnate, the male way of being human as the norm, the female way of being human as somehow a defective version of the male way. Then we look at how it's elevated the risk for abortion for people on the margins of life, racial minorities, girls in the womb, people with disabilities in the womb, how it's corrupted the field of medicine, how it's corrupted our legal system, how it's corrupted the political system, how it's corrupted the culture in a variety of ways. We look at the news media, the social media. We look at big business. And we've seen this, you know, just since the book came out, since the Alito opinion was leaked,
right,
the way that business is shilling for abortion. And so really everything it's touched, it's harmed, and nothing that it touched has it made for the better.
Right. And Alexandra, you all came up with three theses upon which the right to life really stands for these unborn children: the biological, the moral, and the political. Could you briefly walk us through that structure and what kind of gave you the idea to write on those three areas of this discussion?
Sure. So our first chapter, basically, we figured we have to start from the fundamental harm of abortion, which is that it kills an innocent human being. And so we wanted to give pro-lifers kind of the rebuttal to every pro-choice argument you might hear when it comes to the child in the womb. So the first is the biological thesis. This actually is a human being, right? It's not a clump of cells. It's not a part of the mother. It's not a parasite. This actually is a distinct living human being with its own DNA. So that's kind of the scientific case for life. The moral case is, what does it mean to be a human being, right? Why do we have moral worth as human beings? Why is a human being different from a chicken? And how is that, you know, you're always a human person, even from the moment of conception. So kind of rebutting the idea that one could be a human being, but not a human person with moral worth and dignity. And then finally, the political thesis, which is you often hear from abortion supporters, okay, maybe you're pro-life, that's fine. If you don't want an abortion, don't have one. But this is not the role of government to impose on other people, you know, your beliefs, or, you know, this is not something the government shouldn't get in the way between women and their doctors. But any good government is designed to protect its citizens, right? And what kind of government, what kind of society do we live in if the most innocent human beings aren't protected by our laws? And so we're making the case that just legitimate government would do that for the unborn.
Right, exactly. And Ryan, we have about a minute left, but I would love if you could elaborate a little bit on the point that you made that abortion hollows out marriage and the family. How do we start to rebuild this pro-family, pro-life culture, especially now with Roe gone?
Sure. I mean, so the basic argument there is that abortion is the ultimate backstop for so-called consequence-free sex, sex without commitment. If contraception fails, you can have sex with no commitments, no consequences by killing the unborn baby. And obviously, that's a very significant consequence. So I think what we argue in the book is that it can't just be that we prohibit abortion. We also need to be kind of holistic in responding to the sexual revolution. Abortion is a consequence of the sexual revolution. Abortion is also a catalyst of the sexual revolution in fueling consequence-free sex, commitment-free sex. And that means we need to promote a marriage culture. We need to get men and women to commit to each other so then they can commit to take care of that child. And when you get these things out of order, that's where you see the problems.
Makes so much sense. It seems like people can learn so much from your all's book. Where can they find it online?
Right now, it's for sale wherever books are sold. I mean, it may not always be that way, given my history with Amazon. But for right now, wherever you normally buy books, you can get Tearing Us Apart.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much, authors of Tearing Us Apart, Alexandra DeSanctis and Ryan Anderson. God bless you guys.
Thank you so much.
That does it for this edition of EWTN Pro-Life Weekly. I'm Prudence Robertson. Until next time, we'd love to hear from you. Find us on social media at EWTN Pro-Life on all social media platforms, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, we're there. You can also send us a message by emailing prolifeweekly at EWTN.com. We love to hear from you. Remember, life is a gift. Your life is a gift. God bless.